Fix the car soon.
You want to take him off? What is she doing?
Purchasing.
So you come on out, I know that this has happened for the last several years. Come on out and a good time will be had by all. Vacation Bible School. We're going to do Vacation Bible School a little bit different this year. We're going to have a Vacation Bible School day in June, July, and August. It'll be one day each. So I would like to meet with anybody who would like to help me run that, to participate in it, if it's working with whatever group of kids you would like to work with. We're going to meet next Sunday, right after church. So if you would like to help with that, and we can meet all the people we can get. We had one last year, and it was a one day, and it was a huge success. So we're going to do it 3 days, one each month. So meet with me next Sunday, right after church service. Thank you.
Surgery, and after 12 hours in the ER the other night, just about did me in, but I thank God I can say today I am pain free. God took that from me, and I thank y'all for your prayers.
Amen. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. Thank you for that.
Some of y'all prayer requests on Connor. He's a young man. He needs a heart and a liver transplant. He is, if I'm not mistaken, he's a freshman in high school, and this little boy has had a tough road his entire life, and he needs a miracle.
Pray for the mamas that are searching for formulas.
Yes.
We've had issues with trying to find Houston's formula. I have people searching all over, even upstate. And there's four babies currently in Charleston area that have been admitted to the hospital because of this formula shortage. So just keep those families in prayer.
Amen. I believe this is the beginning of what the Bible calls perilous times.
Yes, amen.
Didn't think we would see things like this, but they're right before us.
Amen.
Somebody else? Yes. All right, these that want to be anointed or want a prayer cloth, if you'll come, we want to do that this morning. And those of you that are singing the choir, come swiftly. Come and help us sing this morning. Father, Father, we lay our hands on Brother Bobby this morning. We believe you, Almighty God, for he knows his nails are. We lay our hands on him in faith that you go right where she is. And you touch her, God. God, begin to heal her body and deliver her up in a mighty way. Hallelujah.
Thank you. ushers to come at this time. We're going to take up our tithes and offerings. Amen. Give is given unto the Lord. He's going to bless you to be pressed down, shaken together, running over. He'll bless you. Amen.
Amen.
The old song we used to sing in home church, I started living when I started giving to God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. I would ask Brother Bobby Roper if he'll stand and take us to the Lord in prayer. I'll pray over the offering in Jesus' name.
Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come before you, Lord. Lord, we ask in your hands to be on this offering and tithes that's been taken up this morning. May it be used to further your kingdom, and may we see your fruitfulness in each and every need. Lord, I'm asking that you bless those that have to give and those that do not equally. I'm asking that you touch this service today, allow this service to be the best one that's ever been held in the
Come
and
on.
Lord, as always, we give you praise, honor, and glory. And we do it all in the holy name of the Son. Amen.
Amen. Page 268, I'm on the battlefield for the Lord. Yeah. praise the Lord. Don't stop worshiping him. He's worthy of praise. Amen. We're going to have our special senior brother Martin Marsh to come forward at his time. He's going to bless us with a song this morning. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Sister Stephanie, could we introduce our new drummer today?
Yeah. Our new drummer today is Noah Drinkers, who just graduated from Cape Cod.
Yeah.
Oh, that happy morning when we
Praise Lord, are you ready to hear the word this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Would you give our pastor a hand for filling in the piano this morning? Praise the Lord. I love the Lord and I thank him for his goodness and mercy. Don't you? Amen. And I praise him for who he is.
Yes.
He's King of all kings and Lord of all lords. Amen. We'll turn it over to you, Brother Kyle.
Amen. She said, filling in on the piano. You know what that is, don't you? Job security. I told somebody this morning, you might can find somebody to preach better than me, but can they fold a bulletin like me? Amen. And the truth of that is, you don't even have to fold them anymore. They taught me how to machine them, won't fold it for you, but I shouldn't have told you that. Let's go this morning to John chapter 16. John chapter 16.
Bro, Carl, can I tell you one thing before you start?
Yes, sir.
I want to tell you the early about it. Okay. My sister knows she's been having some problems with her head, and they found cysts on her brain and said that she might have to have surgery. You know? But anyway, we've been praying for her, and I know all y'all been praying for her too. She went and had a test again, and they checked her brain again, so she asked the doctor about the cysts on her brain, and the doctor said, oh, we didn't know about it, you know, so they went and checked it, and when they checked it, there were no cysts.
Praise God.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Come on, praise.
And I know what, I think we got a problem here.
Hallelujah.
Everybody stand up with me if you're able.
Hallelujah.
Stand up. All right, let me see you wave your right hand. Let me see you wave your left hand.
Hallelujah.
All right, everybody say it with me. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, we got a problem. Now see, I thought maybe your shouter was broke, but it looks like everybody's in good condition. That would have been a good place to use it.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
You didn't hear him, but he said, as Sister Hattie says,
come on.
When they went back to check it, there was no
sin. Amen. Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You see, sometimes if we're not careful, we listen to all of these miracles and we hear all these things.
Yeah.
Sometimes the Lord will put a little bit of something on us.
Jesus. Come on.
To show us. You say he doesn't do that. He'll allow it.
Come on.
Sometimes he allows it to come on you.
Yes.
So that you can see his goodness.
Yes.
So that you can see his
light. Yes. Come on.
So that you can see that he's worthy.
Come on, brother. Come on.
And you know, it amazes Jesus for a day. I watch people, they'll go through things, and when God heals them, it's like a big surprise. I didn't know he did that, but he's been doing it all the time.
So yes, come on now.
John 16 and 33. John 16 and 33. What have we been talking about on Sunday mornings? Anybody remember?
Jesus.
Faith. Jesus is a good answer. We've been talking about faith. We talked about the faith to let go. We talked about the faith that we learned from a dead man. Then we talked about the faith to respond to God's word. Will God be made whole? We've got to get up and respond to it, don't we? But this morning I'm going to be preaching to you God's promise to those in trouble.
Come on.
God's promise to those in trouble.
Come on.
And did you know that right in the midst of trouble, the devil would like for us to believe when we get into trouble, the devil would like for you to believe, I've already messed up. I should have been in church all of that time. I should have been praying all of that time. I should have been in my word all of that time, but because I wasn't, there's no hope for me now. But did you know that you can learn faith in the time of trouble?
Yes.
Do you remember that his word says that he is an ever-present help in the time of
trouble? Amen. Yes.
Did you read where he said that we may come boldly to the throne of grace?
Come on.
That we may obtain mercy in the time of trouble.
Oh, yes.
Glory to God. You don't have to get into trouble to learn faith. But I'm glad that when we do get into trouble, God is still there, to give us this precious faith.
Yes.
That will take us through.
Amen.
Yes, amen. The anchor hold. And I was thinking while he was singing, that'd be a good altar call song.
Yes.
I feel like coming back and doing that in just a few moments. I say a few moments, I'm speaking in faith.
Yeah.
And that anchor will hold you.
Amen.
In the time of trouble. John 16 and 33. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
Jesus said, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace."
Amen.
"In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world."
Yes.
"Be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." You may be seated this morning. With God's help, I'm going to preach to you God's promise for those in trouble, or learning faith in the time of trouble. Now, I want you to look at this phrase. He says, "These things I have spoken unto you."
That's right.
And I want you to know just how important it is for you to know what has Jesus said. What is it that Jesus has said, and why did he say it? Well, I'm kind of like Peter. Do you remember when all of the people began to leave Jesus because he was preaching hard? Did you know Jesus was a hard preacher? And he preached things that they could not receive, they were unwilling to receive.
Yes.
And he looks at Peter and the disciples and he says, "Will you leave too?"
All right.
What does Peter say to him?
"No."
"Where would we go?"
"Yeah."
"Because you have the words of life."
"I am."
It's so very important to us to know what Jesus has said, and not just what he has said, but why has he said it.
That's right.
If you read in the 16th chapter, he begins to instruct and to warn, to teach his disciples about what is happening. He said, "The Father sent me into the world, and the Father is going to take me out of the world." He said, "I am here to do the assignment of the Father, and once I have finished that, I will be called back up to be with the Father." Then you get to that 33rd verse, and he says, "These things I have spoken that you might have peace." Somebody say, "Peace."
Peace.
He said, "These things I have spoken unto you that you might have peace."
Peace.
I look around and I see a world that is in complete and utter chaos.
Amen.
I see a world that doesn't know the difference. And I'm going to tell you this. My family was just as lost could be. But when a baby came into the world, we put blue in his room.
Right.
Come on now.
Right.
Where am I? Am I at the Monk's Corner Pentecostal?
Yes,
yes. All right. We put glue in his room. We gave him little G.I. Joes. We gave him tractors and trucks and cars to play with.
Yes.
And when a little girl was born, boy, I'm preaching by faith now. I've got a whole lot of help. And when a little girl was born, we gave her pink bedding and pink. Well, I sound like a dog. I'm sorry. Then we decorated her room in pink. And we gave her pink things to play with. We bought her Barbie dolls and little makeup kits. And I mean, they were just as lost as they could be. But we knew the difference between a boy and a girl. But we live in a world now where I watched, even just this week, as a mother took her little boy into a dressing room at a department store, and she bought him some little boy clothes, and she bought him some little girl clothes, and in front of millions of viewers, she made that little boy put on that dress. And she began to brainwash him about, "Son, you can wear whatever you want to wear that makes you feel good." And I know, if you watch the video, I'm not good at paraphrasing it, but I'm giving you my interpretation. And that mother, you know, my heart began to break because I looked at her, and I did not look at her in disgust or in anger, but I looked at her very pitifully because she's a mixed up woman who is now mixing up another little boy's life. You know, whenever I was a kid, do you know what I wore? You know what I wore? Whatever mama told me to wear, that's what I wore. And she didn't say, "You're going to wear this because this is what little boys wear." She just said, "You're going to wear it because I said wear it."
Amen.
And so we see that there is such confusion in the area of sexuality and gender. And there's so much confusion in the school district. There's so much confusion in our government. And as I look around the church, we've got so much confusion in the church. Used to be a preacher could preach like this and the church said, "Amen, brother." Used to be a time we preached like this and people said, "That's right." But now we're too afraid to be an offense to the world.
Come on.
I'm not here to be an offense, and I'm not here to preach of it.
It's
I'm here to preach unto you the word of God. He said, "In this world you will have trouble."
Yes.
He said, "You're going to have trouble."
Yes, amen.
He said, "But I've spoken this unto you that you might have peace." Now, Sister Helen warned me to never talk about politics from behind the pulpit. never preach about money, marriage, or politics from behind the pulpit. So I come out front so I can say what I want to say. Well, you ain't amening, so I'm going to put my tractor and stump grinding mode, and I'm going to go a little deeper.
Come on.
Back in 2016, we had, Lord, I already feel the kickback.
Come on.
We had a circus competition.
Yes.
Between a woman that believed it was all right to murder babies.
Come on, brother.
It's a wave, and it ain't a wave of glory.
Come on.
We had a circus competition between a woman that believed it was all right to murder babies and a big mouthed man that didn't know when to shut up. I'll tell you, he'd have probably got an office in 2020 if somebody would have found a volume book on that night. And I looked around and I said, is this the best that our nation can come up with? And then 2020 wasn't much different. Boy, I'm telling you. Well, I'm going to preach you every
come
life.
On.
Preach it.
Thank you, brother. We had a circus competition between a loudmouth man and a senile old man. I'm just saying it like it is.
Yes, come on.
And in 2016, I preached in white churches. I preached in black churches. I preached in Baptist churches. I preached in Pentecostal churches. And I saw all around me that the church world was upside down.
Yes.
What's going to happen? In 2020, the church world was upside down. When Hillary Clinton lost, people were biting their nails and weeping. The country's going to fall apart. When Trump lost, you had people out in the streets acting like they had no sense. But I want to tell you, I don't care who sits in
the yes! Come on. Yes. Bless them, Lord. Hallelujah.
I don't get shook up by what this worldly system is doing.
That's right. Come on.
I didn't get shook up when I heard what the Supreme Court did. I didn't get shook up when I heard how the vote went this way or the vote went that way. You and I have got to establish our faith in something greater than today's society.
Amen.
We've got to establish our faith in the anchor that Brother Mark was preaching about. We've got to establish our faith in the rock of all ages.
Yeah.
That he said, if you build your life on what I have said, if you will not just be a hearer, but a doer also, if you hear my words and do them, you are like a man whose house is built on the rock.
Thank you, Lord.
I'll tell you what, I don't care what happens in 20, what's the next one? 2024? I can still sing, I shall not be moved.
Yes.
I shall not be moved. Glory to God. We can still have peace in the midst of the storm.
Yes.
All right, all of you that didn't like my political campaign, I'm going to get back on the wagon. I won't go back there again until maybe next Sunday. My faith is not in the society in America. It's not in what's going on in Ukraine or Russia.
Come on.
As a matter of fact, if you read your Bible, Jesus said these things will come to pass.
Yes. Amen.
He told us there would be a COVID.
That's right.
He told us that there would be an Omicron.
Yes.
He told us that there would be the flu.
Yes.
He told us that there would be diseases and pestilences.
Yes.
He told us there would be a baby formula shortage.
Yes.
He said, I don't see that in the Word, get in the book.
Yes.
And you he already said it was coming to pass.
Yes.
He's already told us these things would happen.
Thank you, Lord.
But he told us in such a way that he warned us. He instructed us how to live in it. He says, these things I have spoken unto you that you might have peace.
Amen.
Now, when you look at that word peace, it means quietness, to be set at one.
Yeah.
Quietness, to be set at one. It also means prosperity. I hear a little politics again.
Thank you.
Do you know that God blessed me under Barack Obama's administration?
Amen.
Preach the word.
He's a Democrat. But Jesus is God.
Yes. Come on.
Do you know that God blessed me under Donald Trump's administration?
Yes.
There you go.
But you said he's a big mouth, but Jesus is God. You say, what about Biden? Oh, he blessed me under Biden's administration. You said gas is up $4 a gallon. Guess what? Every time I go to that pump, I might scrape the bottom of my account, but there's money to put gas in.
Praise God, yes.
Amen. Hey, listen, listen, this is going to blow your mind. When the gas runs out, I still got Pat and Charlie.
Amen, yes.
I can still use the glory of God. If I got to, I move in town. I know how far I can go. I walk to Walmart. I walk to church. I walk to where I've got to go. God is a blessing God, and He is not moved by our political or economic situation. He's a God that causes the rain to fall on the just and the unjust. He's a God that blesses those no matter where they are. When the Israelites were in Egypt, God put them in a place called Goshen. And while the storms were raging all around, while the trouble was hitting against Egypt, God had His hand on Goshen. Yes. I don't know about you, but I want to live in that place.
Amen.
Where it doesn't matter what's going on around me, I can be blessed.
Amen.
I can be prospered.
Right.
I can be set at one. I don't have to fuss and fight over who did this and who did that.
Come on.
I can base my life on what Jesus has said.
Yes.
Amen. Now He says, in this world, you will have tribulation. So don't walk around saying, why did this happen? Why did I go through this? I got a sermon I'm going to preach about. Why do bad things happen to good people? I don't know when. I might just go ahead and kind of feed it in now. Why do bad things happen to good people? Well, this is my first question. Can you find me a good man?
All right. All right.
Come on.
Well, I'm pretty good. No, you're not. Jesus asked the question. He said, who is good except for God?
Amen.
Who here can say that they are good? No, not one. All of us, our righteousness is like filthy rags.
Amen.
So don't walk around saying, why did this happen? Why didn't it happen? Why didn't you go through worse? Why haven't we been cast into hell yet? It's by His mercy that we are not consumed.
Yes.
Because of His mercy that He keeps us from more trouble than what we're already in. But Jesus made us a promise. He said, you're going to have trouble. You're going to have it. You say, well, things are going pretty good for me right now. Well, just wait.
Thank you.
Your share is coming.
Amen.
You're going to go through your lonely nights just like I've been through my lonely nights.
Thank you.
You're going to go to sleep on a soggy pillow just like I've had to go to sleep on a soggy pillow. You're going to have people talk about you just like I've had people
come
talk
on.
About me.
Amen.
So I can't walk around with my head down and whining and moaning and groaning. And why am I being treated this way? He said, in this world, you will have tribulation. You're going to have trouble. Look at somebody and tell them that. I know you didn't come here on a wet Sunday morning to hear somebody tell you you're going through trouble. But look at somebody and tell them, you shall go through trouble. In this world, you shall have tribulation.
Amen.
Can I tell you a few things about trouble? Can I tell you just a few things about trouble? The first one is this. The trials will come.
Yes.
He said you shall have trouble.
Amen.
Job 14:1 says, man that is born of a woman
yes.
is of just a few days, and full.
Oh.
I said full. Somebody say it, full.
Oh.
Wake up. I know you did your hair, so you're here. You put your makeup on, so you're here. Let's wake up and get involved, amen?
Yes.
Man that is born of a woman is of a few days and full
oh.
of trouble. Amen. We're waking up now. He cometh forth like a flower.
Yes.
I remember when I was in my teenage years. I didn't even know why people lived past 40. I'm serious. As a young teenager, I knew it all at 16.
Come on.
I did.
Come on.
I knew it well. It amazed me when I moved out how much I learned or how much my mama learned when I moved out. But all of a sudden, I had to call back home for things I thought I knew. Oh, come on now.
Yes.
Y'all remember those days?
Yeah.
I mean, I had my life together. I was working. I was making money. I didn't have a woman to share with. I didn't have children to take it from me. I was on top of the world. I knew it all. I was preaching revivals, and they'd pat me on the back, and those old ladies would slip money in my wallet and my pocket, and they would kiss me on the cheek and tell me how good I did. I said, I don't need no more for you people back in Cordesville. They need to learn something from me.
Come on.
The Bible tells us that. That every upward like a flower. We come up in the glory of our youth. We come up and think we got it all together, but guess what? The lawnmower's coming through. You will get cut down. Listen to this. He is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not. You and I may be in the peak of our existence right now, but you will face troubles that will cut you down. Amen. They will come. Look at somebody and tell them again. Troubles will come. Although they come, guess what? God is a deliverer.
Yes.
God delivers us out of all of them. I said, if you're a believer, God delivers us out of all of them.
Amen.
Listen to this, Psalm 34:19. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Many are the trials. Many are the troubles. Many are the heartaches of the righteous. But God delivereth him out of them all.
Yes.
Sister Stephanie sings a song. I'm going to leave my troubles on this side of the river.
Amen.
I'm going to lay them down. Never pick them up again. And when I get to the other side of the river, I'm never going to see my troubles again.
Yes.
Well, you know what? We are constantly being delivered. We are constantly being set free from things. Some things you don't even see are happening. Some attacks you don't even know the devil has set up against you.
That's right.
But God is a deliverer.
Yes.
And while you're sleeping, David said, I laid myself down to sleep and I got up again. I had 10,000 camped all around about me, but I was able to lay down and go to sleep. Why?
Hallelujah.
Because God is a deliverer.
Hallelujah.
And he delivers us out of every one of the snares of the devil. If we're a believer.
Amen.
You say, well, what if I'm not a believer? Then you're on the devil's territory.
That's right.
And he's playing with you like a cat would play with a mouse, like a cat would play with a bird.
Come on.
Any of you ever had a cat? I mean, they'll dig up all kinds of stuff and bring it on the steps. And they play with it until it is dead. And then they leave it for somebody else to clean up. This is how the devil works. The devil works that same way. If you are on his territory, he's going to play with you. He's going to torment you. And when you draw your last breath, he's going to move on and find somebody else.
Amen.
But God. Somebody say, but God.
But God.
But God delivers us out of them all.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
What about those thorns in the flesh that we can't get rid of right away? Y'all know what I'm talking about?
Amen.
I prayed on Sunday morning. Then by the time I went to lunch Sunday evening, that same person, usually the thorn is a person.
Well, amen.
My experience. Come on. You pray about it, and you can't get through lunch good before you can feel it again.
Yes.
Paul said, I besought the Lord three times about this thing. I prayed three times for the Lord to help me with this, and he has not answered in the way I wanted him to answer. What is God wanting us to learn in the time of trouble? His grace is sufficient.
Yes.
Amen.
When Paul didn't get an answer, Jesus finally spoke up and said, Paul, in your weakness, my strength is made perfect.
Yes.
Yes.
My grace is sufficient for you.
Thank you.
You know, we've forgotten what grace is about.
Thank
you. We think that grace meets us at the altar.
Yeah.
We get saved. And then you go right on living the way you used to live. And one of these days you go to heaven. That's not grace.
Amen.
The grace of God meets you at the altar. And when you get up, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the
way. Yes.
When I get up from that altar, once I met grace, she grabs a hold to me and she follows me everywhere I go.
Thank you, Lord.
And when I get into trouble, guess who's with me?
Yeah.
Grace.
Grace is with me.
Yes.
When I go through a valley, guess who's with me? Grace is with me.
Yes, come on.
When I get to a mountain that I can't climb on my own, when I get to a river I cannot cross,
come on.
The grace of God is sufficient.
Yes.
I'm not crazy enough to believe that I'm always going to be as healthy as I am right now.
All right.
I mean, I know you can't look at me and tell, but I'm as healthy as a horse. I walk 3 to 4 miles just about every day.
Right.
One man looked at me and said, Brother Kyle, you sure you're walking 3 or 4 miles? I said, yes. My heart's healthy. I mean, it's just so healthy I could take off running right now. I won't do that to you, but I could. I just, after I get done with my walk, I like to go to the pantry, so thanks to the restaurant. But anyway, I'm healthy right now, but I'm not crazy enough to believe that I'll always be as healthy as I am right now.
Right.
I'm not crazy enough to believe that I know that in shall have tribulation.
Amen.
So what am I going to do when I get to the part of my life where my strength is not what it is right now? What am I going to do when I get to the place in my life where I can't do what I'm doing right now? What am I going to do, Sister Renee? Am I going to lay down and quit? Am I going to throw in the towel and say, well, you know what? God has left me and I'm in despair. No, I've got to get up and
yes.
do what I can do. I am for the glory of God because His grace, I said His grace is sufficient.
Yes.
His grace will keep me when my strength leaves me. His grace will keep me when my friends forsake me. His peace will never leave me. Never. I based my life on the solid rock.
That's good.
Yes.
His grace will be sufficient.
Yes.
In the midst of all of our troubles, let me read this to you. Hebrews 13:8. I've quoted it, but you need to put this somewhere in your house.
Amen.
Because some of us think that Jesus was an Easter egg. God made him in Jerusalem. He hatched. He lived, he died, he crucified. We hear these sermons and we go, whack. We think when he went up, that was it. You know what the Bible teaches us, Sister Rebecca? That he's Jesus Christ the same today as he was yesterday, and he shall be forevermore. He wasn't Jesus just in Jerusalem. I said he was Jesus in the fiery furnace. He wasn't just Jesus on an old rugged cross. He was Jesus at the gates of Jericho.
Come on.
I said in the midst of your trouble, God never changes. He said, I am the Lord and I change not.
Amen.
The God that never changes. Now I'm mixed up on you because I don't know who I am half the time. I mean, you might catch me tonight and I might be in a bad mood. I might not hug you as tight as I usually hug you. I might be running around here doing something else and my mind is in a completely different place. I may not have the same personality I've got right now.
Come on.
And don't look at me funny because some of y'all don't.
Amen.
Some of them eat you up when they're coming in.
Yeah.
You look like they could eat you up from there.
Amen.
Did you get so different?
Yeah.
But God is not like us.
Come on.
God is not a man. He shall not, nor the son of man. He doesn't change. There is no changing in God. And the same God that brings me to the trial is the same God that will bring me through the trial. He's the same God in Egypt as he was at the Red Sea. And he's the same God at the Red Sea as he will be at Jericho.
Thank you. Bless God. Yes. God never changes. Hallelujah.
Well, I've been in the church world long enough to see a lot of changes.
Right.
I mean, I remember when you couldn't do nothing but go to church in heaven.
Yes.
Now, y'all were a little more ahead of the times here at Monk's Corner. When I came to Monk's Corner, I was like, Christian people. Well, we was back in the woods, so it took us a little later to get the news. But I remember when the conference said, you can do this, all of a sudden, everybody changed and they started doing it.
All right.
When the conference bent on this, everybody moved. But I'm going to tell you that God is not like our conference. And God is not like our church. God is the God that will never change. Glory to God. He's the same God throughout history. He's never moved, never changed. Look at this with me. Romans 8:18. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. The trials that you are facing right now are not worthy to be compared with the glory that God is doing is working in.
That's good.
You know, God is not as concerned with the storm around you as he is with the glory inside of you.
That's right.
Yes.
That's exactly right.
Do you know that pearl, anybody know where a pearl comes from?
Oyster.
Yes.
It's oyster gut.
That's right.
It's an oyster gut. You take and you ring it around your neck and make it jewelry.
Yeah.
But do you know how it started?
Sand.
It started as a grain of sand that got on the inside of that oyster. And that oyster was in so much of an agitated state that it performs a mucus So you're eating, not eating, you're wearing snotty sand around your neck.
That's right. That's right.
And some people pay high dollars for it. That oyster produces, now I'm not making light of it, it's a beautiful jewel. I mean, man tries to duplicate it, but they can't. And that oyster keeps forming that mucus around that, and I may not be using the right word, but it's a slime that goes around that grain of sand. But guess what? As much as it puts on there, it's still an aggravation to the oyster. So the oyster keeps doing the same to protect itself. But one day, some man is going to come by and take that oyster out of his misery. He's going to pull that oyster up from out of the deepest, darkest depths of the sea. And nobody sees what's going on the inside of that oyster. Nobody knows the agitation. Nobody knows the tribulation. Nobody knows the agitation that this oyster has been through. But a fisherman comes and takes him out of the water. And he'll take that oyster and he'll pop him open. And he will reveal a glory on the inside of that oyster.
Right. That's right.
Well, you know what I'm looking at this morning? I'm looking at a bunch of oysters.
Come on.
I'm a mere deservee on the outside.
Come on.
We have been through some rough stuff.
Yes.
We. If you're not ugly yet, you're going to be one.
Hold on. Hold on.
You got so much to live for. God's going to pull you out of the mess that you're in.
That's right.
The Bible says it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know this. When we see him, we'll be just like him.
Yes.
One of these days, this ugly shell that has been beat on, has been battered, has been left to die at the bottom of the sea, and all I could do was eat on this and eat on that and try to take care of this trouble to the best of my ability. One of these days, God is going to pop me up for the whole world to see and show the glory. Yeah. It is not worthy to be compared with the glory that God has put on. You say that every oyster doesn't have a pearl, and every human does not contain the glory.
All right.
Amen.
There are some people, they don't let the grace of God deal with their infirmity. They don't let the peace of God protect them.
Come on,
Sarah,
come on.
They're bitter, they're negative, they're angry, and life is always going in the wrong direction.
That's right.
But for those of us that lean on the Lord Jesus Christ, he is working something not just around you. You say, I pray nothing changes. He's not worried about your atmosphere or your environment. He's worried about the glory that he has put on the inside.
Yes.
Come on.
You shall have tribulation. That's the truth about trouble. But what does he say next? He said, be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. That term, good cheer, means courageous. He said, be courageous.
All right.
Now, courage is not the absence of fear.
That's right.
Courage is not the absence of fear.
No.
Fear is a natural reaction to some sort of bad news. When I saw those missiles being shot into homes in Ukraine, when I saw those fighter jets, as those mamas videoed that, and you would see the pictures of babies with blood running out their nose and out of their mouth. When I saw that video of that Russian army tank just running over a man in the street and his vehicle in the street, when I saw that, there was a natural inclination in me that said, what if? What if that was me looking out my window?
That's right.
What if that was a picture of my baby?
That's right.
What if, so I'm not going to tell you that I'm so holy that I said, you know, God prevent me in love.
Oh, Lord.
Because a lot of those Ukrainian mamas and daddies were Christian mamas.
Yes.
He did not promise that he would shield us from all trouble in this world.
That's right.
But he tells us in the midst of your trouble to stand up and be courageous.
Amen. Come on.
What does that mean? That means to show strength in the midst of your trouble. to show strength in the midst of your trouble.
Amen.
God gave me a little song not too long back. But it says, He tells me to be, even when I'm weak and weary, He tells me to be strong. That one little line has stuck out to me every time I go through a trouble, every time I go through a trial. I can hear God saying, you might be weak and weary. Be strong. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might.
Thank you, Lord.
Isaiah's Brother Mark gets ready to come and sing.
Thank you, Lord.
I want you to think about this.
It's good preaching.
How can I be courageous? And why can I be strong? Is it because I'm strong in my own strength?
No.
What did Jesus say next? Be of good cheer. I have overcome the world.
That's right.
The kingdom of God is not shaken.
That's right.
By the kingdoms of this world.
That's right.
Amen.
Why is the kingdoms of this world not shaken? Why is the kingdom of God not shaken? Why does God not care who is the next president of the United States? Why does if Russia does take Ukraine, why does that not change the plan of God?
That's right.
Because Jesus said, God entered humanity through the man Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Yes.
And when God entered humanity, Jesus hadn't even gone to the cross yet. But the very simple fact that He had stepped into humanity, that He had lived holy in despite of temptation.
Right.
Though He had been through trouble, yet He was tempted just like we are.
That's right.
He was found without sin.
Without sin.
No guile was found in His mouth. Right. This is why Jesus could say, be strong, because your King has overcome the world. Your King has overcome every force that will try to hold you back. So I don't place my faith in me. I don't place my faith in America. I don't place my faith in the Pentecostal church. I place my faith in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Thank you.
the Almighty God.
Praise God.
Be good cheer.
Amen.
As you leave here today, let that be our praise as we shake some of our hands. As we hug them next today, let's leave and let's just tell them that. Be a good cheer.
Yes, amen.
You know what that means? Be strong. Amen. Be strong in the midst of your trouble. Yes. Amen. He's overcome the world. Amen.
Pastor, I got a text from Michelle. Praise God. Nothing is broken.
Praise God.
Thank you for the service today, for his word,
Lord, for this
opportunity.
this today and how precious it's been. I'm asking you, Lord, please now go on with us as we go about this day, bringing peace, glory, and happiness in our lives, Lord, that you may be able to share it with others. Let others see Christ and see you, Father, in us, the light that you called us to be. Lord, shine on us and stay kind of us. And we give you praise for all that's happened here today. The testimonies that flew, Lord, and more testimonies that's coming. But Lord, we know that they're coming because you're in the middle of it. And we give you praise right now. And we do it all in the holy name of the Son. Amen and amen.
Amen.